I'd like to call this meeting to order. Give a chance to everybody to sit down for a minute.
There you go.
Dave, do you have something? Are you all?
They're having computer problems.
Computer problems, okay. Well, we'll open the meeting and hope we can get the computer problems settled quickly. Presentations, it's my understanding we have none.
Public comments.
Yeah, well, that comes next.
Oh, that comes after presentation.
I didn't have my glasses on.
Next, we have public comments. Just a reminder that public comments are the section of the agenda where the public is encouraged to address the board on issues that they would like the board to hear. And I gather we have some people that would like to do that this evening. This is your opportunity. If you wouldn't mind introducing yourself and a brief description of what you're looking for.
My name is Patrick Siever. I am the owner of the Southern Vermont Storm. This here is Justin Morris. He's our general manager. And James Bates, the player on the Southern Vermont Storm team. He's also one of the wrestling coaches here. Tonight we come to you. We are asking for field usage at the high school. The community has expressed concerns to me that they would like more games from us at high school. So that's why we're here today. Justin Morris has a small presentation that he'd like to bring to you.
Hi, my name is Justin Morris, general manager of Southern Vermont Storm football team.
Does everybody here on the board know what the Southern Vermont Storm football team is?
Do we hear? I have prepared a note sheet to basic an outline in respect to every people too. I'll kind of keep it short and brief. Basically, the Southern Vermont Storm, we are a semi-pro football team out of the New England Football League. New England Football League is a full contact league. Our history, we were created back in 2005 by Bennington native Ty Stratton. From 2005 till about 2015, Ty then transferred the ownership over to Pat, who's the head coach. I came on board with the Storm as general manager in 2015. 2015, when I came on, the process that we do to request football field usage at the high school, I would be in contact via Tim Brown email. Prior to 2006, we did have one game in 2015 at Mount Anthony. It was August 27th. Prior to 2016, once again, email communication with Tim Brown. I had requested possible two dates. I had offered a two-game flex plan. The game in 2015 was a big hit. We had approximately 265 people. Paid attendees, not including, we do have a season pass program. 2016, we had requested that. Tim had gotten back to me via email communication. We were granted the one game. It was August 27th of 2016, I believe. Any additional games he did express to me in email that I would have to go in front of the board to talk with. So prior communication has all been email. The Southern Vermont Storm actually folded in 2016 due to roster restrictions. Pat and myself felt due to injury concerns with the team that we couldn't foster a full team for the 8-game schedule that we were supposed to, 10-game schedule. We had been bumped up to AA. In the NAFL, there are three conferences, single A, double A, triple A. January of this year, myself and our head coach, we had just brought a head coach on, Guy Changa. He's actually a Brunswick native. He started the Brunswick Bulldogs Pop Warner football program. Pat and myself, through discussions, we wanted to bring more structure to the organization. We had a lot of players that were interested. We thought it would be good if we brought in a coach, get a good structure. Even though we are semi-pro, we do try to handle all of our business professional. The only reason why we are semi-pro is none of us are getting paid. We all are doing this for the love and passion of football. There are sponsorship fundraisers that we do. I do mention in the notes. So what I am looking for, well, what we are looking for is to possibly form a partnership with Mount Anthony. We'd like to request possibly not a yes or no answer today. We'd like to maybe sit down at a later day, possibly in March, before I go back to my league meeting to possibly work on some dates. Our season starts July 15th. It typically runs till the end of September. I did have some dates that I mentioned in here, and that's where we're at today. We'd like to do a four-game thing, get the community involved, get the school involved, and basically a joint effort to bring Southern Vermont's football home and closer to the Bennington era.
Thank you.
Area.
Thank you very much. All right, would you like to pass something?
Yes.
Sure.
I have a bunch of copies.
Sure. Just start around. Very good. It is the general policy of this board to refer requests such as yours to the Director of Athletics and the Director of Buildings and Grounds. What they would do, they would take a look at the situation, report to the board with a recommendation, and the board then would make the final decision as to what would happen. I think that procedure should be followed. Tim Brown and Paul will have, I'm sure, I don't know, Paul, have you been aware of this? Are you? Okay. So is Tim Brown aware of this?
I sent the email that he sent me to Tim Brown.
Okay, yeah. Good. So what if we'll leave it at that, if there's no objection, that Tim Brown and Paul will get together, have a meeting, and if I'm sure they'll be in touch with you if they need some further information, and they'll report to the board at our next meeting.
Thank you very much.
Did you have a question?
Hello again, Chad Gordon. Some of you know I'm also a football coach at Mount Anthony. I'm the JV head coach and varsity assistant. And anything we can do, I know they're going to call the senior talk with him, but I think anything we can do to support football, a lot of the players are alumni of Mount Anthony and other area teams. It's great entertainment for the community in the summer. My players love to come out and watch. It's fun, it's exciting, and I think anything we can do to support these guys, if we could do all their games, would be awesome. It really, football is a great sport. I think it teaches a lot of life lessons. The varsity players love to go to the games. And it's just, I think it's a win-win. So I would support them as much as you guys can do anything to support them.
Very good. I would suggest that you speak with Tim and Paul and let them know your feelings, and we look forward to hearing their report at our next meeting. Are there any questions on the board on that? If not, then I think we can move on. I can find my agenda. Finance, the treasurer's report, we need a motion to accept. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Abstentions or noes? None? Can move on then. Budget status report is for your information only. It's on the in the packet. If I don't think we've got anybody here from the business office, but if you have any questions, I think probably the best thing to do would be give Renee a call. Go on then to consent agenda. We need a motion to accept.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on the items in the consent agenda, Dave?
I just want to note the resignation that's in the consent agenda.
Excuse me?
Resignation? Retirement, rather.
Retirement.
Yeah.
Dan Lucy is retiring after reading his letter here. 32 years.
Wow. 32 years for those. He's worked in the guidance department. And he also used as a substance director. What was his title? Someone, Fran, do you remember what his title was?
I can't, but he's been a total of 44 years.
Yeah, he's been here. He's worked with the kids for 44 years. I certainly think it would be appropriate for the board to send a letter of appreciation to him. We'll be sure that is done. Dave, do you have any other suggestions?
No, thanks.
I'm glad you brought it to our attention. Thank you. Okay. Do we have? Can't remember.
Motion.
Do we? Yeah. Do we need a motion? We need a motion.
You had the motion.
We have the motion. We just need to vote on it. That's all. Yeah. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Opposed or abstentions? Very good. Okay, we can move on to policies without Leon being here. I'm a little at lost. We want to adopt these three policies.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we take them individually? If anybody has them. Nathan, did you go to the policy meeting?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Maybe you could sort of act as spokesman on these different ones.
I don't think there's any.
significant changes that occurred in any of these policies. The one concern that seemed to come up repeatedly was that the agency, the state agency that you report to can change, and our phone number can change. So the policy committee wanted to make sure there was wording in there that would make it possible to change that phone number. So we would have to redo the whole policy each time the state had a different agency covering these problems.
I see. And is the wording in these new policies cover that situation?
Yes, yes. It just says, refers to the proper state agency, right?
I see. Mm-hmm. I see.
Yeah.
Well, if we want to take a look at all three of them, does anybody have a question on any of the three policies? Policy 4003, 5005, and 6400.
I move we approve them.
As a group?
Yep.
As a group. Do we have a second to that?
Second.
Any discussion on any of those?
I would just add that most of these meetings are on CAT TV, and they play repeatedly. So if anyone's concerned about the discussion that goes into making decisions, you can see it if you look up on CAT TV policy drafting committee meetings.
Okay, just for my own information, Nathan, how do we access that?
YouTube.
YouTube.
There's a playlist on YouTube.
Excuse me?
There's a playlist which has all of the meetings.
And what would I type in?
It's on YouTube.com. CAT TV Bennington.
Okay, so you would go to YouTube, and then you'd go to CAT TV, mm-hmm. and then you would pick up the individual meeting. You would say policy or whatever it would be.
Yep, the policy.
Just, okay.
Can someone summarize what the optimum class size is? I mean, I can read this policy, but I still don't arrive at a...
Nathan, maybe you could help us.
The main discussion over the months that this has been discussed was that some people wanted specific numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And the policy basically says that the optimum size for any class will be determined by discussion between the building principal and the superintendent. There's really so many different factors that go into what an effective class size is that it was decided that making specific numbers was not really that helpful.
Okay. Ed, do you like to comment on it, or does it help understand
well,
it?
Well, I'm not going to change any minds, but to me that's what I thought it meant.
Yeah.
But it's saying that Superintendent Z and Principal X can determine four kids in a class is the right size.
Yeah.
And I basically disagree with that concept. I think there should be a minimum number of some kind.
Well, is there a state standard? I thought when we went through that policy, there was something at the state.
I heard that at one point too, but I've never seen any documentation on it.
I don't remember seeing it. Tim, do you know the specifics of that?
I don't remember seeing a specific number, but to...
There's maximums.
To address the concern, you would only have a conversation between a building principal and the superintendent. Glenda and I still present numbers to the board. The
right.
board could hold us responsible to say, all right, tell us your thinking. Glenda may come back and say, look, I need to run AP Spanish. It only has four kids in it, but I need it to be a terminal class in a Spanish program. In mine, I might say, you know, I have an ELA teacher that's going to take eight of the neediest kids to do an extra class of reading. But we would be responsible still to the board to come and explain our thinking as far as why we let certain classes run, even though board members might feel the number's too small.
The board does get a printout of class and class size along the way, so we have an opportunity to take a look. I understand your concern, Ed, but I'm sympathetic with the notion that Tim is proposing that situations arise when a small class of, you know, four, five, six is appropriate. And I think that to limit that possibility would be a mistake.
It was particularly around the middle school and high school that the inability to nail down a class size number. In the elementary grade levels, it's much easier to say that you want to keep kindergarten students under 20 and, you know, grades two through four, under 24, or whatever, and I think those numbers are actually in there. But it's exactly those examples that were stated, particularly, like, are you not going to let an AP class run because you only have six students who need it? And that was where it was given to the discretion of the principal to recommend to the superintendent to let it go ahead and run. With everyone being cautious of course, we want to maximize teacher time and utilize all staff to the fullest potential, but there's always going to have to be, and I know at the CDC, where you're also on the board, they do have a class size number, but even that has some flexibility depending on the circumstances.
Right. Yeah.
Well, I think if there is no further discussion, Dave.
Further discussion, actually.
Yes, good.
Yeah, so I'm looking at the policy here, and this is sort of a different question now.
Which policy are we on?
Same one, optimum class size. At the end of it, on the second page, there's a heading that says administrative regulations for the policy. Mm-hmm. And then there are some numbers. I don't know if you have it there, Ed, too, but
20 and 25.
It's got elementary level, the average shall, K through 3 shall be fewer than 20, 4 through 12 shall be 25 or less. So there's some numbers. But my real question is why, this goes back to the discussion we were having earlier, why are there administrative regulations here in the policy? Who wrote them? It doesn't seem to be building level. Obviously, it's combining K through 3 and then 4 through 12. So where does this come from? Is this coming from the policy committee? Is this part of the policy?
I really can't answer that.
So I think we should get an answer to that before we approve it. Or we should at least have an understanding of what's going on. And I don't feel like I have that understanding.
I understand, yes. I don't know. I'm embarrassed to say that I really don't know.
I wish Leon were here. He could.
Well, I think that was put in there because there was so much demand for some kind of numbers.
But that
I don't believe these regs are new.
No.
No. The regs were already there with the policy.
Dave, okay. Dave Fredrickson, did you go to these meetings?
Yes.
Do you have any comment on that?
No.
I went to some of those meetings.
Why?
And I know there was a big debate over having numbers and not having numbers. What you're looking at there for the ones that they gave the numbers for are really for the elementary school level. They're not for the MAU level. The policy part that you're looking at for the this level really leaves it up to the administrators and the superintendent. And I think I know they were debated a long time, but I think what they came up with was something to try to accommodate both groups, and that's why it's where it is.
And it's an average of even those things, right? Dave, I don't have
the
word in front.
And then there is actually, the next paragraph talks about at the secondary level, English mm-hmm. classes, et cetera, et cetera. So there's some detail here. I think Jim's right, it's not new. This was part of the policy. And again, my question is really more about administrative regs versus policies, which are we asking the policy committee to work on? Which are we delegating to building administrators?
What
this looks like, it's so not really, it's labeled administrative regulation, but it's not, I don't think.
The policy originally had numbers in the beginning. And that was the big debate of changing what those sizes were. And what we tried to do was to listen to what was being said about the need for some special type handling of certain classes that come up, and we knew that they would be at the basically a junior high and a high school level. Mm-hmm. It's where you would have the problem, because the other ones you're going to have a certain class size based on the number of students you have in the school. So I think that's what they were trying to do. They're trying to accommodate reasonable requests with reasonable decisions.
Okay. Dave, your concern is that we would like further explanation on how some of this material was devised and got into the sacred, or would you?
I don't have any. I think, Nelson, I agree with you, and I think that leaving leaving it vague and giving general direction, but leaving it open so that you can make exceptions when you need to is the way it ought to be done. I'm really not concerned about the numbers. I'm asking about what are administrative regulations? Sure. So this is a different discussion, I think.
Right. Could we vote on, or we have a motion, really, to did we get a motion? We have a motion on the floor to approve these three. Could we approve or not approve those three? And then we can talk about what we would like to have brought before this board at our next meeting to discuss regs and how some of this wording comes about. If that's agreeable, I'll ask for a vote on the three.
Okay.
Dustin?
Yeah, I was going to have one more discussion. I understand where you're coming from with administrative regs because of a prior meeting we had with administrative regs and changing and how they change them. I think that's a reasonable discussion, but I think that's different than what we're looking at for this policy for class size.
Right.
It's only relevant because it says in the policy, administrative regulations for the policy.
I know.
Well, we do have them in other policies. If you go through the policy manual,
they're also there too. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll put the administrative regs with the policy.
Yeah, I think that's the thing we should be reviewing is the administrative reg policy.
Right. All right. We have a motion on the floor to approve the three. Three policies that were brought before the board, 4003, 5005, and 6400. All those in favor of approval?
Could we separate these? Because two of them I like.
Wait, we've got a motion on the floor. If they want to.
You can turn the motion down, then we'll separate them.
Yeah.
That's the case.
All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? The motion passes. Now, we would like to have I'll be sure that it gets on the agenda and speak to Leon and the appropriate people to bring the discussion up at our next meeting. Any other discussion on this? If not, we can move on then to the administrator's report. Tim?
Thank you. Looking at the calendar, even though there's break next week, it's going to be a busy time. Finally, to see you again in March, so I just want to make the committee and the community aware of a couple of things. We today had another 90-minute delay. I want to clarify that for folks. That doesn't mean a snow day. Students arrived at 8 o'clock. What we do is we have 90 minutes of activity planned, and then we start our school day today. The sixth graders attended a performance of the sixth grade band because the band concert was postponed twice. Snow was against us. So we had a performance which went well. It helped also to give us a chance to talk to our sixth graders about how we participate as audience members. Seventh graders met with staff. We talked about designing a SMART goal. And then the eighth graders were doing college search activities today, so it was a busy start to the day. But again, this continues our use of one day a month for a 90-minute delay to do some of the PLP work that is required to be in compliance with Act 77. I think we've been making some good progress. When I see you again in March, we'll have a couple of other things to update you on as we move forward. The Drama Club will be presenting their play tomorrow at 7 p.m., Schoolhouse Rock. It should be a very good performance. We're hoping the weather helps us out and everybody can attend. We'll be in the cafeteria. School break does start this Saturday. Even though I had a seventh grader today tell me that in the future the superintendent should consider using only 2-hour delay. They've had enough snow days.
I tried on Monday.
They were really, let them know. They were pulling for you this week. I just wanted to say the seventh grade wing. So school break will be next week. School students will be not attending school. When we return on the 28th, February 28th, the eighth graders will be taking the NAEP test. This is a test that is given in reading and math. We have been randomly selected to do this. This year it's a little different. Eighth graders used to sit all together at one time in the morning and take the test. This year the state is having a pilot program. Students are taking the exam on a tablet. Unfortunately, there are only 75 tablets, and we have 200 plus eighth graders, so we're going to be doing a different testing schedule this year, so we'll see how that works out for us. The weekend of the March 2nd to March 5th, the 7th and 8th graders will be taking their annual trip to Montreal, led by department members of foreign language, and that should be fun. Kids really talk about that as a good experience, and we are hoping for a safe and uneventful travel to the north. Winter Carnival, our annual community event, is going to be March 4th. That's a Saturday. It's really open to everybody in the community. It's not a middle school student-only activity. In fact, we see a lot of families bringing very young kids into the school. We put out games, and there's food for sale and entertainment, especially an excellent idea on a gray and gloomy day if you want to get out of the house and run the kids around. So we invite folks to join us. Our students will also be participating in the Youth Risk Behavior Survey. This is a survey that is given to 7th and 8th graders, and we use this information to assess risky behaviors that, you know, our students are being faced with in the community. A good example of what we use this data for is when we applied for the 21st Century Grant, which allows us to have an after-school program, the Mosaic after-school program, and to also program during the summer. We use that survey to demonstrate that we know that the riskiest time for middle schoolers between 3 and 6 in the afternoon. It's a much better thing to have them at school doing an activity that's healthy and safe and providing them with food. So our students will be participating in that. It's about a 30-minute survey. For parents who might be watching the meeting this evening, the questions that we ask are available in the office if you'd like to take a look at that, because there are questions, of course, that address risky behaviors that teenagers might face. Parents are also able to opt out. They can ask their student not to participate in the survey. They just simply have to contact us at the middle school, ask for Ms. Johnson, and she'll make sure that that happens. I do have a handful of students every year who decide with their families not to participate, and that is okay. And then the last thing I for families is the end of our trimester 2 is March the 10th. Excellent time to go on to Infinite Campus, take a look at what your student is missing as far as homework or quizzes that need to be made up or tests that need to be retaken. The students are sure checking that, and it would be helpful if families support them in that work. We have homework club after school Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday with Mrs. Keklak until 5 o'clock. She helps in all subjects, and everybody is welcome. Thank you.
Tim, how would a parent access that information? What would he or she do?
For Infinite Campus?
Yes. I thought you'd said that they could find out, a parent could find out if a student had not fully completed his assignments.
So at the start of the school year, families are given a password so they can log into Infinite Campus and check their individual student. If families have lost that, they can always contact us at school, and we can make sure that they can get back into the system.
So if a parent wants to do it, or and they have lost their or misplaced or forgotten their password, they would just call the school and get another
and
one.
We can help them with that, absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Any questions of Tim? Glenda?
Okay. A lot of things are happening at the high school on the sports front. At the present time, our girls basketball team is 13-3, and they are presently seated 3rd in the state. Our wrestlers have not lost a dual meet yet this year, and their state championship at Virgins are February 25th, and they are favored to win. Our dance team and our cheerleaders have state championships also at Virgins on this Saturday. Our ski team, who last year was moaning the fact that we had no snow, this year has been spending all of their time waxing skis in the cafeteria and getting in condition, because they have been meeting, and their state championships are the 24th at Rickert and the 27th at Craftsbury. And they are looking really, really good. The boys basketball team has two more home games, one on Friday at 7, and their final home game is next Tuesday, and that will also be senior night. And I would really encourage everybody to come out and cheer all of the teams on at these, you know, ending kind of home games for winter sports. And our boys basketball has also qualified for the state tournament. Our swim team concluded a great season at the Berkshire Individuals. And tonight, after the board meeting, I am going to go catch the second act of The Importance of Being Earnest. This team, there's been two casts for The Importance of Being Earnest, which was our school play. And this cast that is performing tonight has had their performances now canceled twice because of snow. So I'm going to try to catch the last act there, and I would encourage any of you who would like to see the last act of The Importance of Being Earnest to come with me. I can get you in. And just a shout out to Tim Foley and all of the kids. It's a superior show. I saw the first cast on opening night, and they were fantastic. Also, Jazz Band has been treating folks to live performances at basketball games, and we've gotten a lot of positive feedback from the players, from parents who've been there, and I really do want to thank Marge and the band for making some time to be there. I also would like to give a shout out to another one of our students who actually placed in, has a poster in Greenup, Vermont, and was awarded. Perrin Patel, he's a grade 11 student at Mount Anthony, was honored in his drawing. He was written up in the paper last week, and that's really an honor because kids from all over Vermont submit art to the Greenup contest, and he was honored that way. And I would also like to shout out to Sophia and another student, Mackenzie Thompson, who have been honored by being recognized as prevention champions by ACT in Bennington. And there was an event yesterday in Montpelier where they were honored, and just they've done some fantastic work with that. So a shout out to Sophia and Mackenzie for that. We are also doing the Youth Risk Behavior Survey, and parents should be looking for some letters home that are going out, I believe, tomorrow that will include all of the information, including timing and how you opt out of that survey. And again, next week is February vacation, so it's a great time to both take a breather, but also we're very three a month in, maybe to the next semester, and just take stock with how things are going as thing moves on. Thank you.
Any questions for Glenda? Not Sophia?
Yes, so on January 27th, the Student Senate organized a winter ball, which we haven't had in a while, and there were over 280 students in attendance. It was very successful. Student Senate is going to donate to the Nature's Classroom program at Molly Stark, because we think that that is very important, and we know that they've been trying to raise money for that. In addition, Student Senate is planning to conduct an event on Friday, March 10th. This is in honor of the Heavenly Hats Spring Hat Parade, which raises money for cancer. And so instead of having the staff and students pay a dollar to wear a hat on that day, because, you know, not everyone can always, you know, pay for stuff like that, we are going to give out a survey during seminars we were talking about earlier to gather data related to the hat rule that we have in school, because we're interested in, you know, why kids wear hats, whether or not it's a sign of disrespect, because there's a lot of different opinions about that, and so we're looking to research that a little bit more. And then Student Senate will be donating from our own funds, because we made a lot of money on the dance, to the Heavenly Hats for Cancer. Second semester began a few weeks ago, and we had open house last week. And in the second semester, our library has extended their hours to before school and after school, which is good because a lot of kids like to go there and do homework and talk to their friends and stuff. And they also held a trivia competition last week, which was successful, and they had prizes and stuff, and kids really enjoyed that. And as Mrs. Cresto mentioned, the sports are ending or coming to a close in their season pretty soon. And a lot of the teams this year had new coaches. We figured out pretty much all of them except for one or two of the teams had new coaches. And so last week, the students on those teams filled out evaluations about the new coaches, which should give some important feedback about that.
Thank you very much. Sophie, I didn't quite understand what Glenda was saying about the award that you won. What was that?
Yes, yeah, so that was the Prevention Champion Award. And so throughout Vermont, different students were nominated for it based on work that we've done, mainly for substance abuse prevention. And so they had kind of an award ceremony to recognize kids that have worked on that, and Mackenzie and I both were recipients of that.
Well, congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Yes, very, very proud of you.
Thank you.
Any questions? Yes.
Sylvia, what's the hat rule?
So we're not allowed to wear hats during class. We can wear them in the halls and before and after school. And we found that some teachers are not as strict about this rule, and other teachers are very strict about this rule, and they don't want students wearing hats. So there have been some issues recently where, you know, kids didn't want to take off their hats because they said, well, this teacher said it was fine. And so we're interested in finding more about how the kids view wearing hats, whether or not it's a sign of disrespect or more of a kind of a cultural thing, because some people feel that it's almost a way where a certain group of students are, it's almost as if they're being targeted because, you know, they could be wearing a hat because they're insecure or, like, you know, they don't have access to hot water or something like that, and then having them remove their hat in the middle of a classroom of peers can, you know, not be a positive experience for them. And so really we're just curious about the student input more, and so we think that a survey would be a good way to get more information.
Very good. Thank you. Once again, any further questions? Thank you, Sophie. Okay, we can move on then. Dave?
Yeah, the Ed Committee met just before this meeting. We had a busy full hour of discussion and presentation from Glenda, and don't have anything to bring in terms of recommendations tonight or any action that the board needs to take. We did talk about a couple of things that we may see, though, at the next meeting, the March meeting. And without going into too much detail on possible changes to the alternative program, enhancements, I guess I would say, to the alternative program, and some decisions on the Emerging Leaders Program, and possibly funding a new, a very small amount of money to fund a new position there. So that would be for next meeting. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Look for that in your inbox.
Anything else that you'd like to?
That's it.
Okay, very good. We can go down, Superintendent.
Glenda?
Sure.
Okay, sure. I'll dismiss you.
Yeah, I would love to catch
I figured
that.
You were waiting to hear the report and they're done.
And I would encourage you guys, if you want to catch the last act, come and we'll get you in through the back door.
Very good.
Okay.
Thanks.
As I said earlier in the Ed Committee, we have used 5 snow days to date, and that is going to impact our end of the year. The last day right now is scheduled to be June 21st. Just remember how we build our schedule. Students need to be in school 180 days. That's the law in Vermont requires 175, but the boards of the supervisory union decided, I don't know how long ago, that 180. When we build the schedule, we always build in for 185 days. We build in 5 snow days. We have now used the 5th day. And we will be looking at maybe possibly some alterations to the end of that year, depending on the end of this year, depending on how many more snow days we use. Hopefully we won't. I'll make note that only delays. As I said earlier, I have the Bennington School District Energy Construction Project, which is going to make all 3 schools a construction zone this summer. I have a contractor just waiting to get in there. They're actually doing work over school vacation week next week. They did some at Christmas. They'll do some in April. And they also are doing some, they will be doing some ongoing. The project is not going to be done completely in the summer, and it could even impact the opening of school come September with any type of delay. I will have a school calendar for you. We have a final meeting on the school calendar Friday, but let me continue with the snow day issue. I did try to do a delay Monday. Called the delay the night before, Sunday night, and then we all, as much as I didn't want a day, I always have to go on the side of safety. And after discussion Monday morning with our bus contractor and the condition of back roads, particularly in Shaftesbury and Pownell, the narrowness, so to give, I was hoping the 2 hours would give enough time to get those widened, but it wasn't going to work. So I can't risk any type of an accident. I do want to, he's here, so I will commend Paul and his staff. I'm also in contact with him in the morning and sometimes at night, as well as Jerry Prue and others, about can the school open? So the, you know, that's the one thing, are the roads open? The other is can their crews deal with the massive amounts of snow that they've had to deal with? We're finally seeing a winter after a couple of not. Paul assured me that if I kept with the delay, it would be less than optimum, but he would optimal, but he could have the school open. I did have Paul check into something. I'm watching the nightly news, and I see a couple of roof collapses in schools in other parts of the country. So I asked Paul to give me an analysis of where we are with ours. And you want to talk about? I don't have to put you on the spot, but you gave me a report today on. Paul did quickly look into that.
So Jim asked me earlier, just what were the school's snow loads and should there be concerns. I did a quick check on the MAU prints from when this building was built, and on the roof specification sheet did point out that the snow load was built to the state standard for Vermont, 40 pounds per square foot snow load, in it on top of all the additional dead load, live load, wind loads, etc. Then did a little bit more digging around, okay, well, what does that mean? Essentially, with some other charts and analysis, 40 pound per square foot is equivalent to about 24 inches of wet, heavy snow on the roof. So, based on those type of things, that's what I'll keep in my head as well. Keep a, kind of keep an eye on our roofs as we go through the winter, make sure that we're not approaching that might be of a concern.
But we're not at the point where we have to remove any snow from the roofs. No. So thank you for getting that so quickly for me. I appreciate that. And again, thank you to you.
The last thing I just point out, because I found that specifically on the middle school one, my assumption, the high school roofs were built to that same standard. I'm still looking to actually confirm that on either print or drawing, but being the state standard, that's make the reasonable assumption it was built to that same standard.
Thanks, Paul. And thank you to you and your crew. The last snow day thing that I want to talk about is today. I did an early release for residents of Woodford. At 11:30 this morning, it was snowing pretty good, and the weather predictions on NOAA looked like it was going to continue throughout the afternoon. So let me bring us back to last Thursday. Last Thursday was a snow day, right? So it was last Wednesday when it started snowing. I decided around 1:30 in the afternoon to take a ride. I sometimes do that, kind of drive our streets. I drove myself up to the top of Woodford, turned around and came back feeling, all right, is our bus going to be able to make it up there? And when I came back down, the chain up requirement sign was flashing, and there were two Bennington police cruisers parked at the bottom of the hill. So I called Mike Gardner of Dufour and said, what's your plan for buses going up to Woodford if the chain-up requirement is there? And his response to me is, well, that's a good question. So I turned back, spoke to the Bennington Police Department. They said, well, as long as you're under 26,000 pounds, you're exempt. So then Mike Gardner gets that message and responds, well, the buses weigh more than 26,000 pounds. So the first, we thought that we could take the bus as far as Harbor Road, which is right past Town Hall, and that's where the bulk of the Woodford students who take a bus are, and there's probably maybe anywhere on any given day 4 to 6 who go all the way up to the top of the mountain. So the bus starts out, gets stopped by Bennington Police, and no, they couldn't go beyond the chain-up area. So the bus had to stop at the chain-up area, and we had been aware that might have been a problem, and Mike Dufour from, I mean, Mike Gardner from Dufour had arranged to get a Suburban, Chevy Suburban there and shuttle the students from the chain-up area. So Renee Gordon, your Director of Finance Operations, and I then sent a letter to Dufour saying, the law's been in effect for a number of years, but was never enforced until they completed the chain-up area at the bottom of the mountain. So now that it's there, they are enforcing it on those days. So we sent a letter to Dufour that they must equip that bus with chains. They responded immediately that they have ordered chains, but they don't. It'll be a couple of days before they have them. So at 11:30 today, the winter warning signs were flashing at the base of Woodford, but they had not yet said that it was going to go to require chains, but it looked like it was going to be that way, so we made the decision to send Woodford home early. It's not the first time we've done that. We did it 2 years ago also. Calls made to the middle school and high school for whatever Woodford students, or basically anybody who's beyond Barney Road on bus 12, were going home early. And of course, as luck would have it, once we got them up there, it stopped snowing. So, but again, we'll always go into Woodford Elementary, also shut down at that time, because we still don't have the chains for that bus. So until the chains are there, which I'm glad that it, school vacation is coming, that'll give us time to get that. But the procedure will be that that bus will have to chain, and we won't have to necessarily send Woodford home early.
We had a handful of students who are interested in living in Woodford.
This is one of those cases where I'm glad I'm not a building principal. I just make that call and say we're going to send them home. And I know that the principals maintain a list of who is on that bus. But, you know, that's Tim's problem to deal with.
As soon as that went out of the population number of kids, you know, I would like to see what's up there.
Well, the curious thing is then I get a call from the high school saying, all right, well, are we sending home students from Woodford who drive themselves? And I said, no, this is really an issue about the bus can't go up the hill. Cars can still go up the mountain, but buses aren't. So unless conditions deteriorate, no, it's just people on that bus. That's just to inform you if you're here, anything about how come Woodford went home early today. It's kind of a long-winded explanation of why we did. And again, it's all about being safe. And the last reminder I have for you, February 27th is the joint budget meeting with the Bennington Select Board. And it's, I know that it's not specifically to deal with Mount Anthony, but it is, you're all welcome to attend 6 o'clock at the Bennington Fire Station, because you know, MAU's budget is a big part of that as long. So.
Is Renee going to have a presentation?
Yes, yeah, we met jointly with Bennington Select Board last Wednesday, preparing the presentation, and now it's, you know, being emailed back and forth between the Select Board's office and our office to finalize what that presentation will be. At 6 o'clock at the fire station, I think. I don't know what the order is yet of where. I know I saw that, but I don't know. Tell me. Just put on your calendar if you'd like to attend.
Did the legislative breakfast take place?
Well, that got canceled Monday, and I haven't with the snowstorm, so I haven't heard of when that will be rescheduled for yet.
No one informed me that it was canceled. I couldn't have made it out anyway. But was there a procedure that members?
You didn't, I was informed that an email went out to.
Yes.
Yeah. So I received the email.
Oh. Yeah.
They don't care.
I never received an email, and I went down there to find out that it was canceled.
Yeah.
Tim, they don't care about you.
No,
as we knew it.
just assume not have me there.
Yeah. I don't know who. With
anyway,
it. So the, we did not we cancel it. The chamber website. Canceled it, and then, well, had you signed up to go?
Yeah.
So
I did it by phone. I called, and there was a number there.
All right.
Anyway, doesn't make any difference. I just didn't know whether it. I was the only one that.
Yeah, because I don't think we would have blasted out to everybody that would have been canceled, or as opposed to emailing who had registered to go. But
well,
I don't know that. So
anyway, there was a lot of snow on the ground.
And I don't have when that will be rescheduled.
Okay. Thank you very much.
I didn't care. It was a Jeep adventure.
any questions for the superintendent? We're still working on negotiations. Our meeting that was scheduled for this Monday was canceled because of the snow. Our next meeting is a week from this coming Monday. We are you know, we're slugging away at it, and I hope to see some progress in the near future. There are a couple of people here. Fran, do you have anything to add to that? Or
no,
Nelson?
I'll just concur with you. Hopefully we have some progress.
I think discussions are going pretty well because they're actually communicating and talking back to a, and forth, just asking questions about a couple of things that we're concerned about.
Right.
Versus just demand. They're not, it's more of a discussion than demands.
Yeah. So we're hopefully we'll have some good news for you. If you take a look at the, for your information, I don't think there's any, shouldn't be any questions on that. If not, I'll look for a motion to go in executive section.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
There'll be no public announcement after it, Richard, so that should take care of that. We'll have it in the conference room.